Thank you, Sarah, for the introduction, and thank you all for coming and listening this morning. During the spring of 1970, Valerie Lamont wrote a computer program. Lamont was studying political science as a graduate student at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. In the early 1970s, graduate students at other American universities were also writing computer programs, most often creating a stack of punched cards to run through mainframes. They were generally students in the sciences, engineering, or the nascent field of computer science. Political scientist programmers were rare, and women political scientist programmers were even more unusual. But the subject of Lamont's program was just as striking. Her program, called Boneyard Creek, presented the history of a stream that ran through the campus and the communities of Champaign and Urbana. Users learned about the stream's flooding and pollution and solutions for those problems. They viewed photographs of the creek on individual screens, and they provided comments to Lamont with personal keyboards below their screens. Lamont and her users clearly were not working on a mainframe with punched cards. They worked on a computing system at the University of Illinois known as PLATO, the acronym for Programmed Logic for Automatic Teaching Operations. By 1969, the PLATO system featured 35 terminals complete with video screens and keyboards connected to a mainframe. During the 1970s, users welcomed the new features of the evolving PLATO plasma touchscreen network, especially its communication features. By 1975, nearly 1,000 terminals on the nationwide PLATO network enabled online communication in the form of bulletin boards, instant messages, and electronic mail. My talk this morning is drawn from my current book project, A People's History of Computing. I focus on students and educators using networked academic computing systems during the 1960s and 1970s. Most historians who have analyzed gender and computing during those decades have considered only the professional realm, and few historians of computing have employed sexuality as an analytical category. Inspired by the recent work of scholars, including our conference organizers Marie Hicks and Lane Nooney, my research employs gender and sexuality as analytical categories to consider users we would now describe as amateurs. PLATO people shared their screens with each other. They swapped messages across the network seemingly instantly, and they traded jokes on digital bulletin boards. Moreover, PLATO people performed gender on and through the system in multifarious ways. I argue that PLATO provided multiple venues in which its people, system engineers and administrators, instructors, students, and other users could explore the boundaries of 60s and 70s heteronormative gender roles. Ultimately, however, the interaction of PLATO and its people reinforced and re-entrenched those roles in unexpected ways. I'll develop this argument with three mini case studies about which I'm happy to elaborate during Q&A. First, examining the nursing work of Marianne Bitzer illuminates the gendered expectations of nurture and marriage built into the system. Next, analyzing the environmental activism of Valerie Lamont, with whom I opened my talk, showcases the intersectionality of gender, social movements, and software. Finally, a close reading of the archived and extensive system notes files, essentially a multi-year online bulletin board, unearths how the ideology of PLATO's promise to revolutionize education for all users masked the misogyny inherent in the system. In 1963, Marianne Bitzer created a new way for her nursing students to learn how to treat heart attack patients. And I know this image isn't the best, but you can see the woman wearing sort of the nursing head covering on her head and sitting at a PLATO terminal. So Marianne chose a striking topic for her nursing students in heart attack patients. Patients would never want student nurses experimenting on them in the life and death situation of a heart attack, but PLATO enabled those students to experiment on a virtual patient. After a short introduction to the system and the terminal, the student nurse watched on her individual screen a 3-minute film which portrayed a conversation between a doctor and a man, quote, to convey an image of a real patient. The film ended as the man experienced chest pains and the student entered into the simulated laboratory on her screen. Here, she could experiment with administering different kinds of nursing care or drugs, such as nitroglycerin, and she could observe the effects of her actions on the virtual patient. While the nursing students worked with Plato, Marianne watched their performance in a separate room on television monitors. And Marianne observed that, quote, minor system failures tended to create anxiety in the student, but overall, the students responded very favorably. So, on the surface, Marianne's research seemed to challenge the gender norms that co-constructed masculinity with engineering and computing prowess. A closer examination upends that. First, Marianne was not just any nursing instructor. She had not independently pitched and secured funding for her Plato nursing project. Rather, she was the wife of Don Bitzer, who invented Plato. Marriage, a heteronormative privilege, smoothed the way for an alliance from which both Marianne and Don ultimately benefited. Don was a PhD engineer, but he was also a salesman. He had sold cars to support himself through college and grad school. And in Plato's early days, during the first half of the 1960s, Bitzer had to sell Plato to grow his project and secure funding. He had to make Plato palatable as a user-friendly educational system. He thought, what could be better than having a bunch of nurses learn how to care for patients using this system? And herein lie more highly gendered tropes. In the 1960s, nursing was pink-collar work performed primarily by women, and it was work whose public image projected nurturing, soft femininity. That is precisely what Donald sought to make Plato more broadly appealing. Remember, at the time, computers were generally remote, inaccessible, and intimidating. To an outside observer, young nurses using Plato played up the juxtaposition between stereotypes of gentlewomen and dominating machines. A woman authoring software to train nurses appeared to chip away at the association between computers and manliness. However, the ways that Marianne's project was deployed and publicized reinforced the nurturing, feminized work of nursing. Now, let's return to Valerie Lamont and Boneyard Creek. As a graduate student in political science, Valerie creatively deployed Plato to stimulate, quote, citizen participation in community planning. She situated her work firmly within the social movements of the long 1960s. Although she presented her Boneyard Creek program as an unbiased experiment in community planning, she clearly constructed the program to persuade users against sheep piling, which was a method of flood control. The 105 slides in her program offered a simple but compelling narrative of decline. Once upon a time, the creek was pristine, but development, pollution, and sheep piling, the work of men, harmed the creek and its wildlife. Lamont shared her program with the Urbana-Champaign public during the spring of 1970, in the months following that first Earth Day of 1970, April 1970. She described each gathering of individuals who used the program as a, quote, demonstration. Her word choice deliberately invoked Senator Gaylord Nelson's call for a nationwide teach-in to raise awareness for local and national environmental concerns. At the end of the program, Valerie urged users to additional action. Her program suggested writing letters to government officials, calling for rezoning, cleanup projects, landscaping projects, and of course, inviting other friends and colleagues to use the Boneyard Creek program. Her program represented a personal and social computing approach to and extension of the April 1970 Earth Day activism. In fact, her approach of education as a pathway to activism mirrored the efforts of other social movements of the long 1960s, especially the civil rights movement. Bringing Valerie to the forefront illuminates the long history of environmental activism in the United States. That 1970 Earth Day did not mark the beginning of local environmental activism around the United States, but rather a concentrated expression of that activism on a national level. And during the 1960s, women, as well as students, were crucial to local environmental organizing. Yet, the PLATO network enabled Valerie's identity to recede into the background, making the creek the central issue. Perhaps Lamont hoped that because the creek cleanup cause, previously had been associated with the all-male group of concerned engineers for the restoration of the boneyard, her program would be viewed as an extension of their efforts and gain credibility and authority as such. Perhaps PLATO, the computer network, offered a veneer of expertise that would not have been accepted coming from Lamont, a woman political scientist. While those concerned engineers could afford to call attention to their cause with Miss Illinois, pictured here, Lamont recognized the precarious position of women claiming scientific authority. Lamont's PLATO program blurred the boundaries drawn then and now between hippie Earth mothers and military-industrial computing cold warriors, but it also masked her identity as a woman. And finally, let's turn to the notes. During the 70s, hundreds, if not thousands, of authors, programmers, administrators, and consultants contributed to the PLATO online community, which was documented through the preservation of 4 years of system notes files. I was ecstatic when I discovered these. Go archivists. During this time, those who touted the system celebrated any PLATO communication as, quote, truly egalitarian because it was, quote, stripped of its stereotypic cues, sex, age, race, tone of voice, physical characteristics, smells, and body language, end quote. Notably, it was always adult white men who exalted this equitable, unbiased version of PLATO, which sounds a lot like Silicon Valley's current mythology of meritocracy. Because, of course, on PLATO, identities were not truly obscured, and the network was decidedly male-dominated and often hostile to women. Notes by women contributors were striking because, and I read through all 4 years of them, because the responses to them were so different from those directed to men. For example, when consultant Judy called out 5 men by name for their, quote, abusive notes, something that men consultants had previously and consistently done, the responses she received were notable in their number, the hostility of their tone, and the personal nature of the comments, such as, quote, sorry you're so bitter. In a similar incident less than a week later, 3 men posted a series of vicious personal complaints addressed at another consultant, Maureen. Subsequent notes revealed that Maureen had asked the men to stop working on a game because their activity was disturbing other students and authors, and also because at the time they were being paid to do other PLATO work. In the meantime, another PLATO consultant implied that Maureen was an ogre because she was trying to ensure appropriate access to PLATO terminals. Ultimately, none of the men were held accountable for their inappropriate use of the system or their ad hominem attacks, nor did they apologize. The women who regularly posted to notes received and complained about harassment, inappropriate comments, and patronizing attitudes. In November of 1974, Ruth bemoaned, and this is her exact quote, "Arg, I am getting very tired of having people call me on talk and ask, what am I doing? If I am female, if my name is really Ruth, if I know of any short games and other nonsense ad infinitum." The responses to Ruth's comment demonstrated the pervasive sexism of the PLATO network. Al suggested that Ruth remove her name from the users list, even though Ruth had clearly explained in her original post that she wanted to remain on the users list so that her collaborators could easily reach her. Bruce suggested that Ruth, quote, develop a sense of humor about it, and then added the condescending comment, if you are really bothered by others who are just being friendly over an impersonal machine, I truly feel sorry for you. Don echoed Bruce's comment, also patronizing Ruth. I really feel sorry for people who can't say get lost when they are up to their ears in work. Al, Don, and Bruce, white adult men, had experienced neither the frequency of crank calling that Ruth received nor the unwanted and inappropriate sexual attention. However, instead of offering sympathy or helpful approaches to her problem, they criticized her complaint. They blamed the victim. The discrimination of women on the PLATO network mirrored women's experiences using PLATO on campus. When women had priority on the system as students or authors, and they asked PLATO gamers, young men, to vacate a terminal, the women were harassed or mocked. The harassment on at least two occasions turned physical. Between Thanksgiving and Christmas of 1974, two women were attacked in the women's restroom closest to the central PLATO lab on campus. Afterwards, one user posted, "What's this world coming to? A decent sociopath like myself can't even have a little fun flirting with a chick or two in the restroom without someone getting all excited about it. I guess I can go back to elevators and stairwells." This response, which minimized the actual problem of violence against women, epitomized the endemic misogyny of the PLATO network and its physical home in Urbana, Champaign. American society seems surprised and aflutter anew every time something like Gamergate emerges. It's treated as an isolated case, right? Relegated to those gamers, while the media simultaneously memorializes the meritocracy of Silicon Valley. Of course, we know not only are the gamers and the mythology of meritocracy intertwined, they are deeply and long-rooted in gendered American social and cultural structures. Identifying as a woman was a liability in the personal and computing world of PLATO a half century ago. Identifying as a man was often inseparable from performing aggressive heterosexuality. Performing femininity within the protection of marriage may have conferred benefits, as it did for Marianne Bitzer. Performing masculinity through association with an engineer-developed computing system may also have conferred benefits, as it did for Valerie Lamont. But Marianne's and Valerie's creation of programs and the PLATO community's collective production of notes were by no means just about the software. These acts, these practices revealed and reinforced the fortress of patriarchal heterosexual power in American computing, just as they chiseled fault lines in that fortress. Thanks.
Thank you, Sarah, for the introduction, and thank you all for coming and listening this morning. During the spring of 1970, Valerie Lamont wrote a computer program. Lamont was studying political science as a graduate student at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. In the early 1970s, graduate students at other American universities were also writing computer programs, most often creating a stack of punched cards to run through mainframes. They were generally students in the sciences, engineering, or the nascent field of computer science. Political scientist programmers were rare, and women political scientist programmers were even more unusual. But the subject of Lamont's program was just as striking. Her program, called Boneyard Creek,
presented the history of a stream that ran through the campus and the communities of Champaign and Urbana. Users learned about the stream's flooding and pollution and solutions for those problems. They viewed photographs of the creek on individual screens, and they provided comments to Lamont with personal keyboards below their screens. Lamont and her users clearly were not working on a mainframe with punched cards. They worked on a computing system at the University of Illinois known as PLATO, the acronym for Programmed Logic for Automatic Teaching Operations. By 1969, the PLATO system featured 35 terminals complete with video screens and keyboards connected to a mainframe. During the 1970s, users welcomed the new features of the evolving PLATO plasma touchscreen network, especially its communication features. By 1975, nearly 1,000 terminals on the nationwide PLATO network enabled online communication in the form of bulletin boards, instant messages, and electronic mail. My talk this morning is drawn from my current book project, A People's History of Computing. I focus on students and educators using networked academic computing systems during the 1960s and 1970s. Most historians who have analyzed gender and computing during those decades have considered only the professional realm, and few historians of computing have employed sexuality as an analytical category. Inspired by the recent work of scholars, including our conference organizers Marie Hicks and Lane Nooney, my research employs gender and sexuality as analytical categories to consider users we would now describe as amateurs. PLATO people shared their screens with each other. They swapped messages across the network seemingly instantly, and they traded jokes on digital bulletin boards. Moreover, PLATO people performed gender on and through the system in multifarious ways. I argue that PLATO provided multiple venues in which its people, system engineers and administrators, instructors, students, and other users could explore the boundaries of 60s and 70s heteronormative gender roles. Ultimately, however, the interaction of PLATO and its people reinforced and re-entrenched those roles in unexpected ways. I'll develop this argument with three mini case studies about which I'm happy to elaborate during Q&A. First, examining the nursing work of Marianne Bitzer illuminates the gendered expectations of nurture and marriage built into the system. Next, analyzing the environmental activism of Valerie Lamont, with whom I opened my talk, showcases the intersectionality of gender, social movements, and software. Finally, a close reading of the archived and extensive system notes files, essentially a multi-year online bulletin board, unearths how the ideology of PLATO's promise to revolutionize education for all users masked the misogyny inherent in the system. In 1963, Marianne Bitzer created a new way for her nursing students to learn how to treat heart attack patients. And I know this image isn't the best, but you can see the woman wearing sort of the nursing head covering on her head and sitting at a PLATO terminal. So Marianne chose a striking topic for her nursing students in heart attack patients. Patients would never want student nurses experimenting on them in the life and death situation of a heart attack, but PLATO enabled those students to experiment on a virtual patient. After a short introduction to the system and the terminal, the student nurse watched on her individual screen a 3-minute film which portrayed a conversation between a doctor and a man, quote, to convey an image of a real patient. The film ended as the man experienced chest pains and the student entered into the simulated laboratory on her screen. Here, she could experiment with administering different kinds of nursing care or drugs, such as nitroglycerin, and she could observe the effects of her actions on the virtual patient. While the nursing students worked with PLATO, Marianne watched their performance in a separate room on television monitors. And Marianne observed that, quote, minor system failures tended to create anxiety in the student, but overall, the students responded very favorably. So, On the surface, Marianne's research seemed to challenge the gender norms that co-constructed masculinity with engineering and computing prowess. A closer examination upends that. First, Marianne was not just any nursing instructor. She had not independently pitched and secured funding for her PLATO nursing project. Rather, she was the wife of Don Bitzer, who invented PLATO. Marriage, a heteronormative privilege, smoothed the way for an alliance from which both Marianne and Don ultimately benefited. Don was a PhD engineer, but he was also a salesman. He had sold cars to support himself through college and grad school. And in Plato's early days, during the first half of the 1960s, Bitzer had to sell Plato to grow his project and secure funding. He had to make Plato palatable as a user-friendly educational system. He thought, what could be better than having a bunch of nurses learn how to care for patients using this system? And herein lie more highly gendered tropes. In the 1960s, nursing was pink-collar work performed primarily by women, and it was work whose public image projected nurturing, soft femininity. That is precisely what Donald sought to make Plato more broadly appealing. Remember, at the time, computers were generally remote, inaccessible, and intimidating. To an outside observer, young nurses using Plato played up the juxtaposition between stereotypes of gentle women and dominating machines. A woman authoring software to train nurses appeared to chip away at the association between computers and manliness. However, the ways that Marianne's project was deployed and publicized reinforced the nurturing, feminized work of nursing. Now, let's return to Valerie Lamont and Boneyard Creek. As a graduate student in political science, Valerie creatively deployed Plato to stimulate, quote, citizen participation in community planning. She situated her work firmly within the social movements of the long 1960s. Although she presented her Boneyard Creek program as an unbiased experiment in community planning, she clearly constructed the program to persuade users against sheep piling, which was a method of flood control. The 105 slides in her program offered a simple but compelling narrative of decline. Once upon a time, the creek was pristine, but development, pollution, and sheep piling, the work of men, harmed the creek and its wildlife. Lamont shared her program with the Urbana-Champaign public during the spring of 1970, in the months following that first Earth Day of 1970, April 1970. She described each gathering of individuals who used the program as a, quote, demonstration. Her word choice deliberately invoked Senator Gaylord Nelson's call for a nationwide teach-in to raise awareness for local and national environmental concerns. At the end of the program, Valerie urged users to additional action. Her program suggested writing letters to government officials, calling for rezoning, cleanup projects, landscaping projects, and of course, inviting other friends and colleagues to use the Boneyard Creek program. Her program represented a personal and social computing approach to and extension of the April 1970 Earth Day activism. In fact, her approach of education as a pathway to activism mirrored the efforts of other social movements of the long 1960s, especially the civil rights movement. Bringing Valerie to the forefront illuminates the long history of environmental activism in the United States. That 1970 Earth Day did not mark the beginning of local environmental activism around the United States, but rather a concentrated expression of that activism on a national level. And during the 1960s, women, as well as students, were crucial to local environmental organizing. Yet, the Plato network enabled Valerie's identity to recede into the background, making the creek the central issue. Perhaps Lamont hoped that because the creek cleanup cause, previously had been associated with the all-male group of concerned engineers for the restoration of the Boneyard, her program would be viewed as an extension of their efforts and gain credibility and authority as such. Perhaps Plato, the computer network, offered a veneer of expertise that would not have been accepted coming from Lamont, a woman political scientist. While those concerned engineers could afford to call attention to their cause with Miss Illinois, pictured here, Lamont recognized the precarious position of women claiming scientific authority. Lamont's Plato program blurred the boundaries drawn then and now between hippie Earth mothers and military-industrial computing cold warriors, but it also masked her identity as a woman. And finally, let's turn to the notes. During the 70s, hundreds, if not thousands, of authors, programmers, administrators, and consultants contributed to the Plato online community, which was documented through the preservation of 4 years of system notes files. I was ecstatic when I discovered these. Go archivists. During this time, those who touted the system celebrated any Plato communication as, quote, truly egalitarian because it was, quote, stripped of its stereotypic cues, sex, age, race, tone of voice, physical characteristics, smells, and body language, end quote. Notably, it was always adult white men who exalted this equitable, unbiased version of Plato, which sounds a lot like Silicon Valley's current mythology of meritocracy. Because, of course, on Plato, identities were not truly obscured, and the network was decidedly male-dominated and often hostile to women. Notes by women contributors were striking because, and I read through all 4 years of them, because the responses to them were so different from those directed to men. For example, when consultant Judy called out 5 men by name for their, quote, abusive notes, something that men consultants had previously and consistently done, the responses she received were notable in their number, the hostility of their tone, and the personal nature of the comments, such as, quote, sorry, you're so bitter. In a similar incident less than a week later, 3 men posted a series of vicious personal complaints addressed at another consultant, Maureen. Subsequent notes revealed that Maureen had asked the men to stop working on a game because their activity was disturbing other students and authors, and also because at the time they were being paid to do other Plato work. In the meantime, another Plato consultant implied that Maureen was an ogre because she was trying to ensure appropriate access to Plato terminals. Ultimately, none of the men were held accountable for their inappropriate use of the system or their ad hominem attacks, nor did they apologize. The women who regularly posted to notes received and complained about harassment, inappropriate comments, and patronizing attitudes. In November of 1974, Ruth bemoaned, and this is her exact quote, "Arg, I am getting very tired of having people call me on talk and ask, what am I doing? If I am female, if my name is really Ruth, if I know of any short games and other nonsense ad infinitum." The responses to Ruth's comment demonstrated the pervasive sexism of the Plato network. Al suggested that Ruth remove her name from the users list, even though Ruth had clearly explained in her original post that she wanted to remain on the users list so that her collaborators could easily reach her. Bruce suggested that Ruth, quote, develop a sense of humor about it, and then added the condescending comment, if you are really bothered by others who are just being friendly over an impersonal machine, I truly feel sorry for you. Don echoed Bruce's comment, also patronizing Ruth. I really feel sorry for people who can't say get lost when they are up to their ears in work. Al, Don, and Bruce, white adult men, had experienced neither the frequency of crank calling that Ruth received nor the unwanted and inappropriate sexual attention, However, instead of offering sympathy or helpful approaches to her problem, they criticized her complaint. They blamed the victim. The discrimination of women on the PLATO network mirrored women's experiences using PLATO on campus. When women had priority on the system as students or authors, and they asked PLATO gamers, young men, to vacate a terminal, the women were harassed or mocked. The harassment on at least two occasions turned physical. Between Thanksgiving and Christmas of 1974, two women were attacked in the women's restroom closest to the central PLATO lab on campus. Afterwards, one user posted, "What's this world coming to? A decent sociopath like myself can't even have a little fun flirting with a chick or two in the restroom without someone getting all excited about it. I guess I can go back to elevators and stairwells." This response, which minimized the actual problem of violence against women, epitomized the endemic misogyny of the PLATO network and its physical home in Urbana, Champaign. American society seems surprised and aflutter anew every time something like Gamergate emerges. It's treated as an isolated case, right? Relegated to those gamers, while the media simultaneously memorializes the meritocracy of Silicon Valley. Of course, we know not only are the gamers and the mythology of meritocracy intertwined, they are deeply and long-rooted in gendered American social and cultural structures. Identifying as a woman was a liability in the personal and computing world of PLATO a half century ago. Identifying as a man was often inseparable from performing aggressive heterosexuality. Performing femininity within the protection of marriage may have conferred benefits, as it did for Marianne Bitzer. Performing masculinity through association with an engineer-developed computing system may also have conferred benefits, as it did for Valerie Lamont. But Marianne's and Valerie's creation of programs and the PLATO community's collective production of notes were by no means just about the software. These acts, these practices revealed and reinforced the fortress of patriarchal heterosexual power in American computing, just as they chiseled fault lines in that fortress. Thanks.
Thank you very much for being here. I will excuse my friend Ignasi, who was, we think about coming together to talk about how Spanish translation worked into our own research, but he couldn't come to Silicon Valley. So what I am going to do today is to offer my approach from my archival work. As Sarah was mentioning before, as an historian, I was working on the history of a computer engineering program in Colombia. But this is a research that is kind of connected because I wanted to move into why this institutional history don't tell about the evolution or the transformation of computing in Colombia and specifically in Bogota. So first, I changed also the subtitle of my presentation, and I am going to introduce one concept that I guess that Morgan was putting together, and is the concept of computer culture. Computer culture was a term that emerged in the mid-1980s and was very used in the literature about technology and education. And if you see here, it's not only Simon Popper who is talking about computer culture, but also Cherry Turkle, who had published this paper on epistemological pluralism in the journal Science, the feminist Science. But at this moment in 1990, this was a different representation of what computer culture means. Because if you look at the archives and you find computer culture is just like the name that people were making to all the things that were happening around computer culture, computing in different parts of the world. And specifically, I found this concept from document that was telling not only the experience in Senegal by Seymour Papert, but also in countries like Chad, Ivory Coast, and Tunisia, and Colombia. And I will tell you how this is connected with a different wave of not linking the MIT, but also governmental policies around the world. So my first approach is to think about popularization, and I'm going to go talk about 1984 because it's a trope. We know that 1984 represents a lot of things for the history of computing or imaginaries about the future. So basically, I was focusing on what happens in Colombia in 1984. So one of the first things that I found in my archival research was this encyclopedia of informatics published by a Spanish publisher that was translated from Italian, and it was delivered in fascicles or in installments. It was like 84 installments that were popularized and sold for people to get into the idea of computer culture. And if you see here, there is this idea that is for the future, that is for today's man who is already in the future, is what it says in Spanish there. But basically, by doing this archival research, I start to found that specifically in 1984, there started to be a lot of initiatives to make people to get into programming specifically. Another media or printed media that is connected with this publication is a computer section in the national newspaper in Colombia. If you see here, it's kind of a mix of very different things. Like in the left part, in the left side of the screen, there is an expert talking about where the computers come. You also find some pieces of code here, so it was also like a way of teaching people how to code basic programs. A lot of advertisement, not only about where can you find or where you can buy computers, but also institutions that were teaching how to program in different parts of the city, or introducing executives and secretaries also to how to learn to work in the program with computers. And this was an interesting topic connected with my previous research, because the editor of this part of this section of the newspaper was a former engineer of Universidad de los Andes, that is the institution that I will focus on today, and it's interesting because the owner of the newspaper is his father, and he actually is now he's the brother of the current president of Colombia. So this person who studied computer engineer became like the most expert voice to tell how a computer must be done in the context of Colombia. And it's not only about the academic way of also how can engineers can become like experts and tell about the agenda of policies of Colombia becoming like a information society country. So this section had a very important role in starting this popularization. It also have glossaries, have also translation from US magazines talking about the future, and as I was telling you, there is a lot of different elements that converge in this computer section in 1994, because it was the year also when this started to be published. But the other connection, and this is again with the idea of Seymour Papert in Colombia, was that he was part of a project that was not located in the MIT as well, but it was located in France, and it was like the Center of Human Resources, led by a French politician, who get into the agenda of how can we deliver these development solutions to countries, not only, as I was telling you, to Colombia, but also to countries in Africa. That is a very interesting way of how, at that moment, Nicolas Negroponte and Seymour Papert moved to France, and there were a lot of Arab investors in making this project to work, because according to Seymour Papert, that was not possible in the United States at that moment. So for me, it was not going or seeing what was happening in terms of education in connection with what was happening in the US, but it has led me to see what was happening in France and how this was also connected with previous histories of elites in Colombia moving to France to be trained in engineering and in other knowledge fields. So it's kind of another like direction that took me to understand other circuits of how this knowledge about engineering was taking place and computing taking place in Colombia. Sorry. And it was also in the context of politics, of the global politics at that moment when the United States was not as interested in Latin America than in other countries around the world. And some of the things that happened in this decade was how a group of countries in Latin America declared like a manifesto in informatics and sovereignty. But the thing here is not only that they were just like addressing, oh, we can be part of this trend, we can be part of the world of informatics. But if you read in the last part, they bring this image of the Romans and the barbarians, and mentioning that if they don't get into this kind of economic of informatics, they could be like be outside of the Roman world. I mean, they becoming like barbarians. So this kind of anxiety about being left behind of civilization is something that you start to find also in these strategies of educating people into programming and computer and computing. So the other side of this story that I want to show, like to contrast, is with some aspects of authority that happen in this context. So I go back again to the newspaper because, as I was telling you, a lot of experts came into this newspaper to talk about the future of computation. How can we create a program that really connects local engineers with what was happening in the world? So this is a Stanford alumni, Jorge Felix, who worked here in the United States. But at that moment, he returned to Colombia to develop a new curriculum on systems engineer. That is the name that the computer engineer program has in Colombia. So at that moment, he reformed the curriculum, and he emphasized that the kind of programming that had to be taught in the Universidad de los Andes was logic programming, and maybe you are more know more about this kind of programming that is basically bringing logic to the structure of how you can develop a software or a program. So everyone who came into the university had to be very rooted in mathematics compared to the idea of popularization that Seymour Pepper was, even though he was encouraging people, children to think more mathematically, here was like a very formal structure that was taught through mathematics to the engineers that came into that university. And that was like a very important phenomenon that happened because the rate of rejection was big in terms of how people could not have those skills and how this came from different approaches. But basically, it also talks about why the Universidad de los Andes, it was the first university in Colombia who create like a program in computer and systems engineer, and it was in the context of development in the 1970s when they wanted to launch this program because a lot of investment has been done by foundations like Rockefeller Foundation and Ford Foundation in encouraging engineers to think about their role in developing the countries. So they have this very background of having connected and exchanges between engineers who came to the US, to Illinois as well as, or to the MIT to go back and make programs to connected to development. And even though it was not the same case, again, France was the place where all these computer engineers traveled to learn, it's still like this idea of traveling and going back to the country to create these infrastructural projects. But the other thing that, again, I'm going because I want you to move from this, I want us to move from this idea of, yes, I am going to focus here This is an ABET report, the Accreditation Board of Engineering and Technology. In 1992, the university wanted their programs to be certified. So one of the outcomes of this visit was mentioning, yes, that Colombia's a national objective was really attached to English, that most students in this university in the programs were taking 3 courses of English, and that that satisfies the requirement for depth in humanities and social science. But the part that most interests me was this last one when they said some transcripts show additional depth for students in other socioeconomic and Greek literature and language. So that is where I want to focus on how these computer culture are connected with these other ways of educating engineers in Colombia. You have to be good not only at economics, but also you have to have skills on Greek literature and language. So that is where I am bringing another kind of actors into this approach to computer engineering and computation in Colombia. And it's something that is, I call grammar of technological uses, because grammar has been a very a central role in social distinctions in Colombia, especially not only with Spanish, but also with English right now. So the actor that I want to bring here is the Colombian Academy of Language and the process of doing, trying to match the technical language that has been increased in the by technologies, and try to match that with the current use of language in Spanish. But as an institution, what I am interested in here is how this is disciplining people into not only speak it right, but also into how to use language in a right way. Because the episode that I was, last year I went to the 60s and I present this episode of a computer that was designed and specifically created in Colombia. This is also from this newspaper, and the journalist, the brother of the president, was the journalist who covered this news. I have been walking through this article, and I find this kind of disenchantment of the practices that were taking place there. There is a lot of manual labor involved. There were a lot of uses or adjectives like rudimentary that are framing these practices as something that was not really, it was not the correct way of making this computer culture to develop. So something that I just want to end and to conclude it is that this kind of approach has also bring me to consider other like historical narratives in terms of how to understand where are these practices of computing could be traced, and specifically between that tension when you can consider that something is kind of legal or illegal. So I brought this concept of surdesarrollo from an Argentinian scholar who brings this a focus to think about the ideas of technological recycling and non-anterized copies as ways to also find other traces in history. And just to finish that, that is kind of very interesting because he has launched me to think about the exchanges in the Caribbean in terms of computer parts. And even I have the opportunity to go to Miami, and it's kind of a very interesting place to see how this specific localization of Miami created this culture of popularization and exchanges of knowledge, that some of them legal, other illegal, took place in configuring the access to computer culture as a bigger concept in countries around the Spanish language. And that it's all. So thank you very much, and hope you enjoy.
Okay, it's really a privilege to be here. The presentations have been so interesting and generative so far. I'm also coming from a media studies background. I generally consider my work media historical. This is one of my forays into software studies. I go to a lot of communication conferences where I don't get to talk about software, so this is really a treat. I did update my notes last night a bit to reflect some of the ideas that that were presented yesterday, and so I also look forward to your questions and comments. You might have heard of this toy, I hope so. I'm going to talk about it. This is not an historical project. It's a software studies project, but a storm of controversy surrounded the 2015 release of Hello Barbie, a Wi-Fi connected doll that maker Mattel claimed finally fulfilled the wish of young girls to, quote, have a two-way conversation with Barbie. Taking to social media with the hashtag HellNoBarbie, activist group Campaign for a Commercial-Free Childhood helped get the word out that a doll that records children's voices was, quote, seriously creepy, a refrain published again and again in news headlines months before the doll was even available for purchase. While hacking and privacy concerns are by no means unfounded, a focus on what Barbie might hear, I think, has diverted some attention away from what Barbie and now her dream house are saying. So as of last Christmas, the dream house is now a smart home that also talks to you, if you have the $350 to buy the talking smart home. Anyway, surveillance concerns over so-called smart toys highlight debates about society's relationship to children, but I'm also interested in how use of the toy itself is one avenue through which a child might develop their relationships within society, and that's the focus of this paper. So whereas baby dolls encourage nurturing, especially talking dolls, whose demands were typically of the feed me, hold me, love me variety, Barbie's adult body makes her a surrogate for imagining other roles the child who plays with her might grow into. And just as an editorial comment, there's an Edison doll downstairs in the software exhibit. So if you've never seen one, that's pretty cool. So this is kind of Mattel's current marketing strategy, which focuses on Barbie as being this inspiration, this inspirational figure who instills convinces girls that being an independent, unmarried woman is a good thing. She's been a doctor, an astronaut, president of the United States, and even a hipster web developer in one of her most recent incarnations. The goal for Hello Barbie, however, was to have her interact as a friend, so not so much a mentor, who asks the child about their interests, tells jokes, plays games, and offers encouragement and advice. Sociologist of technology Sherry Turkle recently stated, and this is a kind of informal quote, not one in print, but I've heard her say, it's not that we have really invented machines that love us or care about us, it's just that we're ready to believe that they do, and we are ready to play their game. And I was really interested in what implications this has when it's children who are playing this game, quote unquote. So my paper asks what might be the result of playing Hello Barbie's game. What kind of friend is Hello Barbie? What kind of friendship does interaction with this toy foster? And then what is the model of citizenship that can be built out of this model of friendship? In order to answer this question, I conducted analyses of both Hello Barbie's dialogue and the software that's used to script it, which is called Pulstring. So, old technology allusion there. Since the release of Hello Barbie, the Pulstring software has been made available for free to individuals who register with the company. So it's a chatbot scripting program that doesn't require programming abilities that you can use to build things like Alexa skills and so forth. So I've kind of done a little bit of discursive backwards engineering to take the kind of the script and try to figure out what the scripting rules might have been that went into creating it. A brief note here about my method, just kind of coming out of yesterday's keynote, why software? The quote on this particular slide is really typical of a kind of surface-level gender critique of Hello Barbie, that too much of her dialogue focuses on fashion, for example. And these word clouds kind of give you the general idea. One of them is of all of the words, and one of them is of just the nouns. I don't know what kind of processing went into creating these because I just stole them off the internet, but it gives you some sense of what the big topics are that Barbie talks about. But there are a couple of problems with this. First of all, it assumes that the binary of serious or good topics and frivolous or bad topics is kind of natural, without really interrogating the structures that define and perpetuate that binary. And second, it implies that you can just solve this problem by adding more words, which I'm not sure is really the right solution. So I'm working from a perspective that is specifically critical of post-feminism as a sensibility within which choice and difference are celebrated and usually commodified, but in which stark gender inequalities still abound. We've already seen excellent presentations that demonstrate how software can structure language use, and it's at that level of what Noah Wardrip Fruin calls expressive processing that I'm interested in with regards to Hello Barbie and other chatbot smart toys that are positioned in the child's world as friends. So on one level, friendship can be seen here as being deployed politically to model specific performances of citizenship. As we've seen in other presentations, cultural localization of the content does not necessarily constitute a politics and may actually undermine political work. So for example, you can tell, or the parent can tell Barbie or tell the software right at the beginning which cultural holidays this child celebrates, and there's a whole list of them that you can choose from, but is that kind of multiculturalism really a political move, or is it just this kind of re-commodification of cultural difference and identity? So I'm arguing specifically that being friends with Hello Barbie is post-feminism for six-year-olds. Wendy Chun argues that one reason to take software as one's unit of analysis is found in the paradoxical nature of software itself as both seen and not seen, known and not known. Software's combination of elements, so its interface, its algorithms, is a model of, this is her quote, everything we believe is invisible yet generates visible effects. And this is much like communication itself. So it's really it's not that surprising that the metaphor used for conversation in polstering is software. The documentation states at its core, a conversation is composed of inputs and outputs. These elements of conversation ensnare these invisible processes of communication when they are described as, quote, capturing a stimulus to the system, such as what the user says or does, as inputs, and making this visibly equivalent through the interface to what the system produces as outputs. In this case, it's the stuff that Barbie says to you. Intuitively, we understand that there's no way to account for everything that someone might try to input into the system, especially a child, but the software models this seemingly infinite variability by steering it into only four categories. You have rules, events, intents, I-N-T-E-N-T, and fallbacks. Rules and events are roughly equivalent to procedures and actions, which are the comfortable domain of computation. But here they're merged with these metaphors of intents and fallbacks, which are categories that basically become metaphors for human purposes and contingencies, right? So anything that you put into the system that it doesn't recognize, there's a fallback phrase that then loops you back into something that the system can deal with. At its core, a conversation with a bot is just an exercise in advanced pattern matching, and authoring and polstering is basically the action of establishing what patterns are to be matched. This form of human-machine interaction is common and well understood because it often works. When a response interests us or even just prompts us to keep interacting, we quite willingly participate in the so-called Eliza effect, or believing that a system understands us. Eliza creator Joseph Wiesenbaum famously unmasked his own program in a report published in Communications of the ACM in 1966 because he was concerned about this danger in believing that the computer was offering, quote, judgment deserving of credibility, an idea which he later expanded more in this book, Computer Power and Human Reason. However, I'm more interested in the idea of this quote that I pulled out of that 1966 paper, where he reminds us that Eliza's rules contain embedded assumptions about the world, and these are the assumptions that we internalize when we can sort of succumb to this Eliza effect, especially children who maybe have less experiential knowledge of the world than adults. So what do Hello Barbie's rules tell us about the performance of friendship enacted through conversation with the doll? I'm going to give you a couple of examples. Where am I on time? Okay, perfect. Okay, Hello Barbie's training phrase is, it's fun to make new friends. Right away, the child's successful interaction with the doll is predicated on a performance that acknowledges relationship to the toy as part of the category friend. Okay? Almost everything in Barbie's world is fun or exciting, and from the beginning, or adventurous is the other one that shows up a lot. From the beginning, there's little option but to agree that expanding one's social world is, quote, fun, especially since the fallback is usually
Whoops, I didn't quite hear you all the way through. Make sure you hold down the silver button on my belt the entire time you're talking. Can you try again? Okay, say, it's fun to make new friends. There are a couple of variants to this that ask the user to speak very clearly. So one of the interesting things about this particular toy is the speech clarity of children as well that they've had to sort of accommodate in the scripting. The user must get past this training exercise in order to be rewarded with the promised fun of a conversation with Barbie. When one does, she cheers enthusiastically, "Hooray, I think we're set." Barbie initiates the conversation all the time, this is for everyone, with an icebreaker. What's your favorite color? It responds with more enthusiasm when a keyword is recognized. So I just kind of put up there the recognized colors. The script is designed to respond directly to a recognized answer with two speech acts, a constative in the form of an alliterative affirmation. Red is rad, green is great, pink is perfect, purple is whatever, you know. And a directive, which is always the question, what do you like about it? And then this steers the user through the script. Even in this relatively banal exchange, the Eliza effect is immediately encouraged. The affirmative semantic content, the enthusiastic tone and cadence of the voice actor, and the positioning of the user's affective state at the center of the exchange. Why do you like this? Sets up the conditions for the user to accept that the doll understands. Eliciting a response that puts the user in this loop is also the goal of the intents and fallback of this particular event stack. If the user asks Barbie what her favorite color is, she says, "I love pink, but also blue and orange. I guess it just depends on my mood, you know?" Which, even through the semantic content, even though it's different than the previous affirmation in question, it really follows the same model of, you know, any of these color choices are okay, and what do you think? So it's kind of the same type there in terms of speech acts. To belabor this point, forms of the response, "I don't have a favorite color," are met with, "Oh, you don't have a favorite?" Either requiring that you confirm that you don't have a favorite color, or giving you an opportunity to sort of reconsider and re-engage in that loop. If the user's response is not a recognized keyword, so if your precocious child says their favorite color is puce or something like that, this kind of generic affirmation is offered that then, again, just re-engages them in the loop. So this particular conversation is pretty innocuous, right? Why would I choose this as an example? One's favorite color is not really seen as a political commitment most of the time. Every user has infinite choice, and every choice is validated. If a color isn't represented, it could be easily added as a keyword, theoretically, to the point at which every single Hello Barbie user could have their special color recognized and affirmed as valid. And there's really nothing wrong with that. But in this harmless exchange, personal validation is granted at the expense of negotiating boundaries, or what Donna Haraway has called the category work of politics. There are no structures to be dealt with here. Every snowflake gets a crayon in the box, so to speak, but the crayons have little agency with regards to the box. The box, in this case, later proves to be the kind of taste commodification that celebrates individuality for its market value. One of Barbie's games involves, for example, decorating the child or the user's dream room. She will remember this conversation and remember the favorite color when she recommends swatches for the paint on the walls of the dream room. Never mind the class assumptions sort of embedded in this model of a world where every child has a wall that they can paint, for example. From here, users always then begin a conversation with Barbie by getting to choose between playing a game or having a chat. And these are the basic sort of two categories within this script options. So this sounds like it's a fairly encompassing model of the world. We might consider what is not covered by playing a game or having a chat. I don't know, daily actions of negotiating structural and other conflict, for example, is invisible. Even if that seems like too heavy a burden for a toy to bear, having a chat obviously must leave a lot to be desired when the other chatter is a bot. So it's also sort of promoting this idea that there are bounds to what kind of thing you can talk about. Practically speaking, that's probably a good thing in terms of modeling the world. Some of its deficits might be of concern to us. So For example, Barbie's fallback for seemingly every word in the dictionary that expresses hurt, confusion, or disappointment is, quote, "I think it would be better for you to talk to your favorite grown-up about it. They'll know the best way to help." It's not necessarily the worst fallback in the world when you're, you know, when you're talking about these kinds of topics, and if you're going to trade off with, you know, what the chatbot might conceivably be able to say. Obviously, most of the branches in Barbie's event programming are not designed to trigger these kinds of negative affects. But there is one topic for which Barbie's scripts will try to get the user to negotiate conflict, even bring it up, and that is with advice about friendship. So there is a conversation script where she says, "Tell me about one of your friends," which is kind of the starter. Barbie wants to know what you like about your friend. Keywords include fun, games, play, and all the related synonyms that keep the conversation going. The script encourages this kind of definition of friendship that values these particular feelings. Laughing, this is a quote, "Laughing is one of the true secrets to friendship. So tell me about a time when your friend made you laugh." This is an example. But there are also affirmations for loyalty. So Barbie will tell you about her friend Teresa, who, quote, "is always there for me," and ask if you have a friend like that. If you don't, Barbie can be a friend like that, she tells you. She can be the person, the friend who knows exactly what to say and do, even when you're feeling kind of down, is the way she puts it. So a user can be kind of down, and Barbie will ask if there's a secret to cheering you up. Do you like jokes or funny faces? So if you're kind of down, do you like jokes or funny faces? That's reasonable, I assume. But in this model of the world, distraction is kind of the best medicine for discomfort. It is of note that discomfort is always an internal state that can be changed internally, right? So the only accepted discomfort is something that you can change. Barbie recognizes a few external causes of feeling kind of down, things like moving or being the new kid on the team or that kind of thing, but only those easily overcome on one's own with one's sort of own emotional control. Keywords related to trauma will trigger the favorite grown-up fallback. Barbie cannot talk to you about hating anyone. There's a clip of Sherry Turkle kind of... I really admire Sherry Turkle's work, but this particular clip, she's talking about Hello Barbie, and she says, you know, it's this toy, then you can sit down with it and talk about how you hate your sister, and that's not going to actually get you very far in these scripts, because as soon as you use the word hate, it's going to trigger this fallback. It will never let you talk about anything negative like that. So she can't talk to you about being teased or bullied. She can't talk to you about being a bully. I mean, none of these topics are allowed in the script. And maybe that's positive, right? I mean, maybe that's a responsible choice on the part of the script writers. But she will take opportunities to encourage you to be thoughtful and loyal. I'm going to breeze through this because I want to be able to play the one-minute video clip so you can hear what she actually sounds like. This is... a pattern that occurs quite frequently where she has kind of randomly generated a conversation topic. In this case, it has to do with just watching the stars, and will turn it into an opportunity to have the child reflect on their relationship with someone else in terms of them being thoughtful and concerned and a good listener or a good teammate or a good somebody who is a good citizen is always the good friend, the good listener, the sort of passive, emotional, bucket, I guess, for other people's experience. Unlike the color script, the Eliza effect here is accomplished by not bothering with keyword matching at all. The user's led into an activity for which there is a pre-existing social script that's triggered, in this case, wishing upon a star, and uses that expectation that wishes are good to enroll the user in a conversation that seems to be about, again, their internal state. So it's back to that feeling. In many ways, these passive qualities are highlighted because of the constraints of the chatbot interaction. They are kind of more platitudes than qualities. They necessarily ignore active contexts, including political context. So it's kind of hard to imagine a girl being inspired to persist, for example, the sort of feminist mantra of the day now. Barbie's dialogue is written to reinforce answers about apologizing, listening, and appreciating others. Practically speaking, it's because these solutions do not require negotiating with the source of the problem. right, which is imaginary and external. While the user has an abundance of choices about the type of music they like, what they want to dress up as for Halloween, and what color to paint their room, there are not many options for being a friend. Consumer choice is active, but interpersonal relations are passive, as are, by extension, politics, when, quote, good citizens are defined by their willingness to listen and accommodate. So this is just the proverbial tip of the iceberg in terms of the actual conversations that are scripted for interaction, but a pattern has already emerged. The validation of personal taste is used to support the illusion that the doll understands the user, which is then the basis for labeling this interaction as friendship. Consequently, friendship takes on the passive characteristics and limitations of the chatbot's model of the world, specifically a model in which the messy entanglements of politics are eschewed in favor of internal states like thoughtfulness and consideration. While thoughtfulness and consideration are necessary, they are not enough. They do not teach us to engage in the category work necessary to building a more equitable world. So, thank you. Do we have 2 minutes to do it? Okay, it's pretty short. I just lost it, sorry.
Barbie, do you think that women can have it all?
Which breakfast did you say?
Okay, I think that says a lot.
I would think Barbie's a feminist. She's had a lot of careers throughout her life.
How do you feel about the wage gap, Barbie?
Once in a while, I catch myself dancing, sometimes for no reason at all. How about you? Do you dance anywhere and everywhere?
Barbie, do you know what second wave feminism is?
Well, cereal sounds delicious.
I was wondering, what do you think about Sheryl Sandberg?
Oh, you know what's good? A dream diary.
This is so weird. I'm over it.
You're so smart. Such
okay,
a
I like it again.
Friend.
How do you feel about the fact that we never had a female president?
Not even an itsy-bitsy, eensy-weensy bit. You know what I want to talk about? Fashion.
I don't want to talk about fashion with Barbie. I think we have different senses of style. She has permanently raised feet, and I wear these types of shoes.
Sometimes I get a little nervous when I tell people my middle name, but I'm really glad I told you. What's your middle name?
It can be really fun to play with Barbies.
I like you, Barbie. I feel like we're gonna rise through the ranks together and, you know, be like high-ranking career woman.
And anytime I can help you out, just let me know, because that's what friends do. Oh, I have something I want to ask you about fashion.
Oh.
I've been working on a story that expresses what I think fashion is all about. Would you like to hear it?
Incidentally, Barbie does talk about sneakers when she asks you about your shoe choice. So anyway, all right. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Our final paper on the panel this morning is from Ramzi Nasser, who is an independent computer scientist, and he is presenting a paper entitled Kalb Lughat Barmaje, which I've been practicing all morning, okay? And also have been told that there's 5 different ways to say that, so hopefully that was the classical Arabic version. I tried. Ramzi is a computer scientist, a game designer, and educator based in Brooklyn. He researches programming languages by building tools to make computation more expressive and implementing projects that question the basic assumptions we make about code itself. So if you would like to know what it looks like to create a thoughtful and very logical order in a panel, I would say you're seeing it right now. His games playfully push people out of their comfort zones and are often built using experimental tools of his design. He is a former IBM fellow and a professor at schools around New York, and he will take it away in just a moment.
Sorry, just got a...
No problem. So anyway, like I said, I live in LA. And yeah, it's fine.
I disabled the mirror. So I wrote my own slideware, which I do more often than a normal person should. Let's see if it works. So So you go big, and you stay here, and I can control you? Yes, I can. Ooh, computers, they're great. Oh, hold on, it's that backwards, sorry. Okay, almost there, I promise. You, okay. I want you, because my demos are over here. Okay. You go, you do that. Ah, great. Yes, I love computers. All right. Hello, everyone. My name is Ramzi Nasser. Thank you for the wonderful intro. And I will be talking to you about this project that I have been working on for some time, a couple of years now, called Alb Lughat Barmaje. That translates to HART, a programming language. It's also a recursive acronym, but we don't have time for that. And the sort of exploration that I've done into the what I've been calling the cultural baggage of computer science. Like was said in the intro, there's a bunch of things that I am. I'm a computer scientist. I write code for a living. I teach. I'm also an artist. But I also want to emphasize the things that I'm not. I'm not a historian. I'm not an academic. So I'm very honored to be here in this space and to come to you all and to learn from you. But my approach and methodology is much more applied, so to speak. I'm sort of in the trenches, in a way, sort of reflecting on the present, and I'm trying to reason about where I feel that I find the state of the industry and the state of culture as it deals with computers. And this is where I'm at on the internet, if you're into that. So I want to start with this. Does this look familiar to anyone? Show of hands. One person. Maybe this is a little better. A couple of people. Yeah. Right. So I want to start my talk with a sort of like where this trajectory of exploration started for me, which is this visceral feeling. I'm Lebanese. I grew up in Beirut, and I grew up doing web development in Beirut, which meant that all my websites had to be in English, Arabic, and French. One of those was a nightmare, and I sort of began thinking at the time that it was, it's quite peculiar that this one human language it looks like this a lot of the time. But I also, as a computer scientist, I understood that notion to be kind of absurd, right? Like, how can a computer be good or bad at a language? I studied the Turing machine, right? This thing, it makes no assumptions about anything. And yet the evidence mounts. This is a screen grab from a video by Google about how they connect the world or something. And this is some attempt to show that all the languages that they support, and this is not Arabic, I don't know what it is. It's a result of running correct Arabic text through a graphic design suite that assumes English and then not showing it to an Arab before you go live. This has manifestations in the real world. This is an artist in Georgia who really wanted to stick it to Donald Trump by printing out "Make America Great Again" in Arabic, and that's not that. And I like to think about the like number of people that this had to go through in order to get put up on a billboard, and none of them were Arabs. I love if you could see in the corner, one of the comments is someone named Yumna saying, "You spelled it wrong." So Yumna gets it, and that's... this happens so frequently that I have enough content to maintain a blog called Nope Not Arabic that documents incidents of butchered Arabic in the wild. This is a screen grab from the film Captain America Civil War, whose budget was $250 million. And you could see in the ear behind the actor's ear is some more butchered Arabic. So none of that $250 million went to anyone who could read Arabic or anyone who cared. So even when Arabic is correct, it tends to be so ugly and of such poor quality that it borders on illegibility. This is the only font that the Amazon Kindle packages and ships for Arabic. If you're not an Arabic reader, it's hard to describe how bad this is. If you could imagine a Comic Sans mixed with papyrus and a like sort of a dash of Joker Man thrown in for those who like know bad fonts. And then imagine that being the only way to sort of consume your written culture on a device. This has led me to actively just not read Arabic on my Kindle, ever, right? And it's particularly frustrating because Arabic is a culture that has an absurd level of attention to text. This was one of part of the ELB project that I don't really have time to get into, but there was a parallel between the traditions of computer scientists and their relationship to text and the traditions of Arabs and their relationship to text. Even when it's not ornate, I've sort of fallen in love with Ottoman cartography recently, and the Ottomans would use the sort of stretchiness of the Arabic language to stretch out the labels of areas to cover the areas themselves. So you see the label for Britannia Jadid, New Britain, covering all of Canada, and the like labels for the oceans just hugging the oceans. These are not things you can do on a computer today with Arabic. So I found myself marinating in this world that that can't really represent Arabic on computers, but my focus has been on not so much on the content, although that's something I'm shifting into, but I want to talk to you all about something a little bit more foundational today, which is programming. And this is a Python terminal where I'm trying to assign a variable that has an Arabic name, right? And I get an error as a result. So I believe very strongly, almost maybe to a fault, in the promise of computation and its ability to amplify human thought and empower people. I really do believe that. But that's sort of where I began in Parsons, which is where I pursued in my master's thesis. I began thinking about expressive programming and what does it mean to build tools that augment human expressivity. At the same time, I started teaching programming and thinking about what does it mean to make a programming system that can be taught to people. My critiques at the time were more about the legacy systems that we've inherited from the 60s and how they make assumptions about computers that no longer exist and they're needlessly difficult to learn. But that quickly turned into thinking about what does it even mean for something to be learnable. And if you're learning this sort of written code, if it's in a language that is not native to you, what does that mean, right? And this is a conversation that I didn't really see happening in the circles of creative coding or teaching, code teaching. So my response to that was to build a programming language. And this is a screen grab of ELB. ELB is a real programming language. It's not a speculative piece. In fact, this is the ELB interpreter. Let's see that I can write code. I just printed out the word hello. I've written a game in ELB. This is Pong. Or Bunj. We don't have a P or a G. And that's the source code running in the background. So it's important that this is not, it was important to me as an artist that this not be, you know, a thought puzzle or a speculative piece, like I said. By actually building it, it unearthed a lot of truths about computer science. And before I dig into that, I just want to point out that ELB is an extremely boring programming language by design. It's a kind of language that a first-year computer science student might write for homework, right? It's textbook, new run-of-the-mill, it's a Lisp interpreter. The only difference is that it happens to be in Arabic. And when you make that single distinction, all hell breaks loose. Getting it to render in browsers initially was, I had to do a lot of work. Using standard programming tools all sort of crumbled. The GitHub repository is still hyphen, 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 and it always will be because GitHub assumes Latin names for projects. And there's a whole, I've given talks on like the things that break when you do that, but I want to focus a little bit today on these questions, right? So it's hard to render Arabic. Infrastructurally, there are assumptions about Latin. What is going on, right? Like, how did we get here, and what is really actually happening? And the reality of software is that you have to build on top of what others have built on, because the computers are complex to the point that they dwarf the human mind. No human can keep in their head everything that goes into making a computer. We like to imagine that we're the kid on top sort of doing a cool stance, but in reality, there's just piles and piles of people underneath. And this feels to me like a collaboration. It feels to me like writing software is always a collaborative act. Even if you're doing it on your own, you're collaborating with the people who built the system that you're standing on top of. And it's a linguistic collaboration. You're talking to these people. You're forced to talk in ways that they've had you talk. This is the architecture of macOS, which people estimate has between 40 and 50 million lines of code in it. And the best estimates for the number of lines of code a competent programmer can keep in their head are around 10 to 20,000. So no single human can actually know how this works. You need armies of people. And what that means is that there's always a social aspect of writing code, because you're always engaging with this. And to be concrete about that, I want to sort of point at this snippet of C programming. And the Latin alphabet and the English language manifest in three ways, not to get too deep into parser theory. But you have words like include, int, and return. These would be referred to as keywords. These are baked into the language. You can't, return will always be R-E-T-U-R-N. There's just, you'd have to build a new programming language to get away from that, and I did. Literals are like actual data or content. Some work needs to be done there to enable things that are not Latin as well. So the sort of hello world in quotes doesn't represent something else. It is literally the string hello world. The problem, these two are solvable. The problem, though, is in printf. Printf here is a command that comes from another library. Some other human wrote that procedure, and some other human named it printf. And printf here is not a decoration, it's not a visualization. That is how that instruction manifests in the binary. You have to call it by that name to use it. And that is where ELB as a project fails. It cannot consume code from the community, from history, because they've all been named in English. In many ways, hell is always other programmers. So for ELB to do graphics, it would have to use something like OpenGL, and it would have to use these commands, gl attach shader. No other word will do that. That's the one. This isn't just limited to code. In order to interact on the web, this is an HTTP packet. To request a web page, you have to construct this packet. Again, this is not a visualization. It's literally get /. And if you don't do this, the server on the other end will ignore your request, because that's not the web. You've violated the protocol. These are the things that make an entirely Arabic programming experience impossible, and more specifically, an entirely non-English programming experience impossible. And I've been focusing on Arabic because that's where I come from. That's my perspective. But this is really about everything that isn't English, right? Because programming is inherently this social sort of act. Tom Mullaney yesterday talked about a false universalism in computation, and this is sort of what I'm getting at. I want to be a little specific about the term entirely here. I mean that you cannot build a programming experience where pulling back layer after layer, you will not eventually run into English. In order to do that, you'd have to reinvent the last 60 years of software engineering, and that sort of defeats the purpose. There's a term in computer science, there's a kind of algorithm called the greedy algorithm. And it's an algorithm that sort of does the best with what it immediately knows. So this is a greedy algorithm trying to create the longest, or the chain of the highest value. Between 3 and 12, it picks 12. Between 6 and 5, it picks 6. And you see that it misses the 99 down the line. And this is how I kind of viscerally feel about the history of the way software gets built. People, when you read the transcripts of Dennis Ritchie and the people who built these systems, you see that there's no active malice here. There's just people trying to do their best in the most immediate term. And you end up with specifications like this. This is from ISO IEC 9899. Or what's known as the C11 specification. This is the most recent specification of the C programming language. But this clause has been unchanged more or less since C was standardized. And this specifies what is allowed as a command, as a function identifier. And you see that it's this finite list of alphanumeric symbols. It can't really be anything else. And that's because when this was originally written, this is the best people had time to, gotta get it done. And we've inherited this because we are in constant linguistic collaboration with the past. Another way that I think about it is is, and I'll get to this towards the end, is the tension between perceiving something as a feature of your system or the basic metric of correctness of your system. And support for other cultures gets talked about as, oh yeah, we'll get to it. But when you're a member of those cultures, the system is simply not correct until that support has landed, so to speak. So this is a hard problem. I've been talking about ELB I've been doing this kind of research for a while, and a number of non-solutions have surfaced that I just want to sort of dismiss so that the Q&A could be somewhat more productive. There's the notion of automatic translation. It's like, well, what if you just like machine translated all the English functions into your culture? I reject that because it creates this sort of second-class status of like an original language and a recipient language. It's also incredibly buggy. The Arabic text there says lesbian, which is, I don't know why Google believes that that's the translation, but there it is. There's a constructed languages have come up, in particular Esperanto. I also have to reject this in general because a constructed language is a big ask. And I haven't really seen one that is reasonable in practice. And Esperanto in particular, you'd think an international auxiliary language would look more like Arabic, Hindi, or Chinese. But an international language that looks like Latin is something that I have to be a little bit suspicious of. APL was a programming language that was primarily symbolic. Its core was these mathematical symbols that you can see on the right-hand side of some of the lines. But it suffers from the same problem, right? Humans want to name things. Names are valuable. And people have sort of followed in the ELB footsteps and built programming languages in their own native languages, which I think are wonderful art pieces and provocations, but I don't see this as a sort of long-term solution. ELB was never meant as a long-term solution, as a provocation. Because if I can't consume this code, then we lose the sort of magic and the power of software, the fact that I can sort of build on what others have built. So I don't have a technical answer there. But one other industries have faced similar things, and I look to the aviation industry briefly, and the aviation industry is one where when you're trying to land a plane with 200 people on it in a crosswind, that's not really the time to be musing about the cultural hegemony of the English language. And they know this, so they picked English. That's the solution. And they're not shy about it. The solution, to quote, is the air-ground radio telephony communication shall be conducted in the language normally used by the station on the ground or in the English language. So every pilot has to learn English just in case they're landing in an airport where they don't share a common tongue. They go a little further. This is in another draft recommendation. Where the second clause I love, they say, in the case of international aviation, however, perhaps more than in any other arena, English sheds all connection to political agendas, real or perceived, and becomes simply another tool for increased safety and efficiency of aviation operations. So we can debate this, whether it's problematic or like reasonable. But the fact is that this is an industry that made a choice and has documents that I can point at. Software engineering has effectively done this, right? Except I can't really point you to a document. If there is something, I'd love to hear about it, but I haven't seen this. English is the only language to perform software engineering in. There are auxiliary, sort of watered-down versions of writing code, or things that sit on the surface level of that mountain, but to really do software engineering at a industrial scale, it's done in a single language. And we might get to other cultures if we have time. This is the false universalism, and it only happens at the surface. I wanted to include this screenshot of what a C programming tutorial in Arabic looks like. These videos are incredible, but this is an Algerian person whose computer is configured in French. You could see in the bottom the start menu. And he's explaining an English programming language in Arabic, and there's just this like weight of like linguistic colonialism just dragged into this single thing. And no time is devoted to like, isn't it curious that we've inherited, because dude's got like a job to do. And he's like trying to prepare people so they can be effective in the workforce, right? So all of this stuff just gets you know, no mentioned, internalized. This becomes a survival tactic, right? Halcyon yesterday talked about forced assimilation through accent bias, and this starts to feel that way. So I'm torn. I feel that you know, there's a prerequisite to learn English inherent in programming that we don't talk about. We talk about you know, programming's or computers' ability to offer freedom and empowerment to people, like on the One Laptop Per Child project, but then they ship with Unix terminals with commands that are entirely written in English. So we talk about how anybody can learn to code, right? How development, you know, the word democratization gets thrown around. And when I say we, I mean the sort of contemporary mainstream software engineering industry. Words like natural language processing, human-readable text, plain text, get thrown around even when the reality is only English. And this serves to just sort of further paint the alternative as not natural, not human, not plain. I'll jump through to the final sort of point just to look to the future. These are two examples of organizations that believe they're building the future of the web. This is one group called a Blockstack that's using the sort of blockchain, and another group called IPFS that's using an alternate technology. The details of them are less important. What is important is that they both really believe that they're building the future. And this is Blockstack's description of what a name is in their system. It's uppercase and lowercase ASCII characters. So this is an instance of the past being dragged very much into the future. Whereas IPFS insists that their paths must be universal to avoid oppressing non-English societies. So use UTF-8 and not ASCII. So until, as long as we keep talking about computing, or as long as computing continues to be talked about in this false universalist perspective, I think real harm is being done. And until support for other cultures is not less a feature and more a core principle, I don't really see a way forward. And that's the sort of the best sort of vision of the future that I can construct. So thank you.
Okay, so can I bring Ramsey, Sarah, and Halcyon into conversation? Because I think that you've all referred to each other. Sarah, you had that quote at the bottom of one slide about the perlocutionary act. So it seemed to me that you were reminding us that it's not only the sound of our voice that lends to a sort of supposed understanding, cognitive completeness, but it's an entire worldview and a kind of history, as Ramsey said, a history of other people who did things that made things infrastructural that you inherit. And I wonder if we could get Halcyon in that conversation to talk about how there's more going on than simply Google trying to be helpful or Siri trying to help you be understandable.
Yeah, there's a something I actually wanted to ask you, or just bring up that you had that mentioned that really stuck to me, stayed with me. The notion of like everyone gets a crayon in the box, but there's a box, right? And there's no conversation about the box. So the idea of a sort of mobility or agency like within oppression or within a sort of bounded agency is something that I felt in your work and yours as well and a lot of the stuff that I'm looking at. So it's the same. You know, there are lines drawn, and you can do whatever you want within them, but let's not get outside the box. I don't really know what to do about that, but that's a pattern that I've seen.
Yeah, one of the things that struck me about Ramsey's work is I think it's going to be about individuals making a decision that this is something that they want to tackle, particularly when it comes to speech technology, the market is driving, you know, the development, and I am hopeful. I didn't mention this yesterday, but I am hopeful, particularly because so much of what is being done in speech technology is open source, and because of cloud computing, and we were chatting about this earlier, that individuals can make those kinds of decisions and say this is a project that I want to take up. So, for example, I'm aware that the next big development for Siri is going to be for Indian languages. That's a market-driven decision. It's the next big market. But it is about programmers in developing countries who are going to say, listen, this is... I am not only going to take the Koreans out of the box, but I'm going to create a new box to operate in. I think that that's going to be sort of these individually driven projects. I think that's where we're going to see the development.
I don't know how articulate I can be about this, but a couple of thoughts, things I wish I knew more about. Some of the history of this project is that my book project is actually about speech synthesis, and in particular, it's about the sound of speech. It's not actually about natural language processing. I kind of bracketed that to look at the sound, and what's interesting to me is that most of the criticism of computer speech for 30 years up until very recently was about, it has to do with gendering, and specifically the gendering that is a kind of alto-toned, calm female voice, right? This one that is sort of bureaucratic in nature that kind of keeps everything in line, right? But to the all the crayons in the box issue, recently we've seen this explosion where you can, within some limits, actually choose whose voice you want to hear in your device. And so I think some of those strictly gendered aspects are being questioned, but at the same time, what is the implication of still choosing that voice and having that one voice in your ear all the time, right? So there's no negotiation of those boundaries involved there. Just as an aside, one thing I'm really interested in that I know absolutely nothing about is how tonal languages are being interpreted in speech analysis, which is something that is actively going on, obviously, with Chinese, but something that I would really like to understand a lot more about how they're interpreting. So.
Okay, thank you. Let me get over to the other side of the room.
Thank you all for such a provocative panel. My question is for Joy and Sarah together, if you could comment on women's authorship or women as authors, what alternatives exist in both situations that you've posed to us, historically, present day, whatever. I'm thinking about the use of AI and chatbots in therapy settings as well, and what it means to think about the designers and the centrality of gender, thinking about gender in this sort of design and authorship process as well.
I'll start. One thing that I found really interesting immediately when I started working on Plato is that they explicitly called anyone who wrote a program an author. And I just chose three case studies from hundreds because there were actually many women who authored programs from the French department or the Spanish department or, you know, sort of take your pick, as well as the sciences. But it's less clear to me, or maybe there's less documentation about whether they simply viewed those programs as extensions of their work and their teaching because they weren't provocative in the way that Valerie's program was or that Marianne's program was. But certainly they had feminine names and identified as women in their work. But I don't get a sense. It's a sort of a case where initially on the surface I thought, oh wow, there are all these women in the 1960s who are doing this programming, and like it doesn't seem to have mattered. Or maybe they found that they were so marginalized that they chose to step away without documenting that as well. I wish I had a more hopeful story.
Yeah, I would just say I struggle with what authorship is and how we talk about it. Just to kind of bring it to this particular software, I'm not a very good programmer at all. I'm sort of even sometimes feel limited to markup language. I can use this particular pull string software because it doesn't require me to think too heavily about the logic structures of creating the script. Most of it is templated, and there are these big, thesauri of terms and all the keyword matching and all of that kind of thing is sort of done for you. Who is the author then of this sort of experience? Is it, the programmers who wrote the program that's basically an interface between me writing, I can create an Alexa skill, right? And I can make it as flexible as possible. Have I then authored that, or have I been pre-authored by the people who wrote the software? What about the people who are using the skill and their ability to position themselves in relation to it? I mean, there are so many levels here that I don't have a really good answer, but it's a very, very good question. I think one we have to keep interrogating all the time in terms of what do we mean by authorship and what does that have to do with the power structures that we're interested in.
So this is a question for Ramsey. So I have a friend who's a pilot for Qantas, and he says that when they fly from Australia to Asia, they just don't even pay attention to the radio when they're over Indonesia because they can't understand the Indonesians speaking English. So there's a breakdown, so it doesn't actually work. The system, so they just look at the radar more carefully to check there's no other planes around. The point is, I was just wondering whether, thinking about that in terms of software, to what extent do you think this is not just a question of about just inclusion of more people, but whether perhaps not that it's dangerous not to include, like it might be with the planes, to include other languages, but whether there are possibilities for doing and thinking in very different ways about programming. Like, does something brand new or radically different potentially come when you write a program in Arabic or Chinese or whatever?
Yeah, so I like that my one hopeful, another industry is, no, it doesn't even work. So the question of do new kinds of thought become possible given a different programming? So this has come up a bunch, and I don't really have a good answer to that. ELB is semantically equivalent to a very basic scheme, Lisp, so it doesn't really afford, you're typing a little differently. There's a notion of syntax and semantics, and semantics sort of sculpting the way you think, and syntax being an interface to that. So I don't know how much. I feel like if at the very minimum your access to those semantics are affected certainly by the syntax that you use. This is something that some people have disagreed with, but I do think it makes a difference what language it's based on. Whether that affects the semantics immediately, I don't really have a good answer. That's something I haven't really even figured out how to interrogate. That's the best I have.
I'm not sure whether this question is lost in translation or what have the Romans done for us. But if you could program completely in Arabic, and someone else can do a programming completely in Spanish, and someone else can do a programming completely in Hindi, what happens when you try and send something across all three networks?
That's the exact nature of the problem. And it's not a technical problem, is the sort of argument that I'm making. This is a human problem. How do humans communicate? And that's why I think, the perspective, as an engineer, it's just bytes. What's the big deal? But when you think about it as how do you get someone who only speaks Arabic and someone who only speaks Spanish and someone who only speaks Hindi, how do you get them to communicate with each other? That's just hard, right? Whether they pick a common language. I know historically, I didn't know this, but lingua franca is an actual language. I only learned this while preparing for this talk. I thought it was just when French was dominant in the world. It's no, the sailors in the Mediterranean invented a sort of, you know, averaging of Italian and Arabic and Berber and Spanish to be able to like do their jobs. So maybe there is some kind of constructed middle ground language. It certainly will not be Esperanto, right? It'll probably look a lot like Chinese and Hindi. I mean, it's just by the numbers. So maybe that's the solution. But if you don't have that, if you end up with these siloed cultures writing code or forcing everyone to sort of, you know, adhere, I think a lot is lost. I think being able to sort of communicate at that sort of abstract level is what makes this stuff so powerful, and we lose so much, I think, as a community without being able to do that. But yeah, I don't have a good answer beyond that.
We have time for two more questions, so we'll go here and then to Marie.
Thank you guys for the great panel. I also have a question for Ramsey. I just think it's extremely fascinating what you're doing, especially the fact that it's, you know, not just theoretical, but actually something that, you know, somewhat works or does work. You've put it on GitHub and everything, and you've mentioned other people have taken up the sort of software and other languages mantle that you've got going on. I was wondering if you could sort of talk a little bit about what the response has been. I mean, do you get a lot of backlash from people for doing this, or have people been mainly supportive? So, I mean, just sort of what's the response been on this, sure, on this project?
Yeah, I'll be quick. It's sort of ranged. It's funny that Y Combinator is here, because when the project went live, it went up on Hacker News, and it got the kind of reactions you might expect. Some people missed the point that it was a provocation, and they're like, "Oh, this will never work." And it's like, "Yeah, I know. That's the point." There was some sort of shocking racism, the sort of what you'd expect. I had it installed. This I could never parse this. I had it installed at a gallery once, and you know the code was just running, and these like two people just walked by and like one whispered to the other, like, "Well, I hope they don't use it against us." I'm like, I don't really know what that means. Like, I don't know. Like, I hope they don't use this buggy, slow, boring Lisp against us. Like, So it's been mostly either like the reaction has been like curious or supportive or missing the point, and there's been some sort of hate. The reaction from back home, though, has kind of sort of broken my heart. A lot of people will see it and get excited about it, and for a few years I was stuck in this performance art loop where people would email me like, "Oh, how do I get started?" And it's like, well, the cultural hegemony of English, and I just have to give them the sort of spiel. So I think people want something like that right there, but it's not. It's not as within reach as we would like.
Real quick, so we've heard a lot about how languages always have a nationality from, you know, Halcyon's work and from your work, Nasser. And my question is sort of for Sarah. Do these generated speech technologies always have a gender, or is it sort of the exception to the rule when they aren't gendered? And I was wondering if you could just talk a little bit about that or the history of that.
Something I do know something about, thank you. So one of the points that I struggled with when I wrote my dissertation that I'm trying to work out in the book version is that there's a lot of embedded gender bias in the development of speech technologies. Maybe you found this as well, that comes across as evolutionary. So if you read, so one of the most widely cited, if you go through and read any journalism article about the gendered nature of voice synthesis, you're gonna see one name, Clifford Nass, who was at Stanford. And everything he writes basically says children prefer kind of what you were talking about, I think, right? The youngest, like babies, and babies prove everything. Babies want their mother's voice, right? And people want a voice that matches their gender, and that is what they find most credible. And it's just accepted as fact in the development literature that if you want to create a perlocutionary voice chat agent, you're going to match those characteristics for that audience. And it's a cart before the horse kind of question, right? Like, are those preferences cultural?
I mean, we can't. How do we test whether or not those preferences are cultural? But what's interesting is, and I'll just leave you with this because I know we're out of time. But all of the this was last year. All of the checkout registers, automated checkout registers at what's the name of the UK grocery chain?
Tesco.
Thank you. Sorry. Went from male to. From female to male voices last year, and it was because they had gotten so much feedback in the years prior, and they'd been automated with voice checkout since 2004 or something like that. They got all this feedback that customers were tired of, like, literally the bitchy female voice telling them to take their groceries with them. And so they changed it to a friendly male voice, and what's interesting to me is that the friendly male voice is actually coming to dominate now. So if you've looked at Jibo, for example, I'm working on a paper on the casting of voice synthesis, because I think the way we're sort of casting these roles in terms of the voice actors that are being chosen is reflective of the cultural assumptions that are kind of changing over time as we interact and experience these technologies. So it's a really good question, but it's also a moving target.
Okay, so with that, I'd like to thank all of you profoundly for an absolutely fascinating panel this morning, and thank the audience for your adherence to the question guidelines, which made for a really interesting Q&A. So thank you, everybody. Let's have a round of applause.